In our urban world, in the streets where we walk, in the buses we take, in the magazines we read, on walls, on screens, we are surrounded by images of an alternative way of life. We may remember or forget these images, but briefly we take them in, and for a moment they stimulate our imagination, either by way of memory or anticipation. But where is this other way of life? It's a language of words and images which calls out to us wherever we go, whatever we read, wherever we are. Where do they exist, these fabulous rewards and objects and people? Where do they belong to? Here, there, or nowhere? They come with us everywhere. We take them away in our minds. We see them in our dreams. Publicity proposes to each of us in a consumer society that we change ourselves or our lives by buying something more. This more, publicity persuades us, will make us in some way richer, even though we will be poorer by having spent our money. And publicity persuades us of this transformation by showing us people who have apparently been transformed and are, as a result, enviable. This state of being envied is what constitutes glamour. And publicity is the process of manufacturing glamour.
Come forward more.
Glamour is supposed to go deeper than looks, but it depends upon them utterly. Glamour works through the eye and the mirror.
Oh yes, this is all over of the darkness. All over, I'm not a professional hairdresser. Can you get the tangle out?
Glamour is for everybody who believes they can be glamorous, or perhaps more accurately, for everybody who finds that they cannot afford not to be glamorous.
Yes. Keep the fringes free, Oliver.
Yeah. The setting in which glamour is here being created is an old one, a large country house now turned into a public park. These parklands and trees were once laid out in the same spirit as the landscapes in oil paintings, in which idealized nymphs and goddesses played.
They're trying to make it look like three flowers in the trees.
Come in a little bit more. Can you? No, you stay there. That's nice.
Now, the model has taken the place of the goddess. Yet glamour is a new idea. For those who once lived in the country houses and owned the classical oil paintings, the idea of glamour did not exist. Ideas of grace, elegance, authority amounted to something apparently similar, but fundamentally very different. When everybody's place in society is more or less determined by birth, personal envy is a less familiar emotion. And without social envy, glamour cannot exist. Envy becomes a common emotion in a society which has moved towards democracy and then stopped halfway, where status is theoretically open to everyone, but enjoyed by only a few. Glamour is new. Society has changed. But the oil painting and the publicity image have much in common. And we only fail to see this because we think of one as fine art and the other as commerce. Sometimes publicity impersonates a painting. Boys are posed to match the boyhood of Raleigh. Real people pose, like the figures in Manet's Déjeuner sur l'herbe. A man dresses up to look like a portrait by Hals. Sometimes works of art are used to give prestige to a publicity scene. A doodle by Michelangelo. A painting by Rubens. A painting by Dürer. A whole sea by Hokusai. Usually the references to art are less direct. It is a question of publicity echoing devices once used in oil painting, devices of atmosphere. Settings. Pleasures. Objects. Poses. Symbols of prestige. Gestures. Signs of love. Oil painting, as I tried to show last week, was a medium especially developed in order to render on canvas the physical texture and tangibility of things. Today, color photography performs a similar role. Color photography, oil paint. publicity and oil painting use many of the same references and celebrate the same qualities in things, share many of the same ideals, all of them related to the principle that you are what you have. Their purpose and their effects, however, are very different. The oil painting showed what the owner was already enjoying among his possessions and his way of life. It consolidated his own sense of his own value. It enhanced his view of himself as he already was. It began with facts, the facts of his life. Of course, there were other facts which it didn't take into account. Where did the owner's wealth come from? The exploitation on which his wealth was based was not shown. But what was shown did at least correspond to the condition of his own life. Publicity is different. It appeals to a way of life we aspire to, or think we aspire to, but have not yet achieved. A publicity picture suggests that if we buy what it is offering, our life will be different from what it is. Scene after scene shows you this different life. Not only will our home be different, but all our relationships will become radiant because of our new possessions. But we can only achieve such radiance if we have money. And so publicity also works on our anxieties about money. Urging each of us to scramble competitively to get more. Making money appear as if it were itself magical. This may persuade a few people to use a bank credit system despite the very high rate of interest. But what is more important is that it promotes the illusion that a man's ability to consume is directly related to his sexual virility. According to the rules of the dream, those who do not have this power, those who lack glamour, become faceless, almost non-existent. Publicity both promises and threatens. It plays upon fear, often the fear of not being desirable, of being unenviable. It suggests that you are inadequate as you are, but it consoles you with the promise of a dream. Behind the dream are the working lives of the very people it addresses. With this spray, you will be wanted. Meanwhile, there is the present of the women who manufacture such sprays. Future deferred. Meanwhile, the interminable present. The more monotonous the present, the more the imagination must seize upon the future. The passivity of the present is then replaced by the activity of an imaginary future, pictures conjured up by publicity. The imagery may be public, but the dreams are intimate. Here are three such dreams. The dream of later tonight. You are part of the good life they smile at. They are part of the good life you smile at. Everyone is surrounded by what brings pleasure, but it is you who will bring the greatest pleasure of all. Next morning, you'll still feel the same about it. The skin dream. The surface you can touch. The skin without a biography. Dream of a faraway place, to lie down on a bed alone, to allow one's thoughts to pass through the light of the window, to travel elsewhere, conjuring images. Distances without horizons. To be in two worlds at the same time, just where Europe ends. The other world, violent, infidel, full of unknown passions. Wearing your own clothes next to your own skin, you join the nomads. To go north, to ancient castles. An age of chivalry, of romantic love. It is dawn. You are innocent, you are pure, you are ready to travel again. Publicity works on the imagination, but it does something else too. Because publicity pretends to interpret the world around us and to explain everything in its own terms, publicity adds up to a kind of philosophical system. The things which publicity sells are in themselves neutral, just objects. And so they have to be made glamorous by being inserted into contexts which are exotic enough to be arresting, but not close enough to us to offer a threat. A machine gun can support shoes. Revolution can be wrapped around anything. In this way, publicity abuses the realities of public figures and events and struggles in other parts of the world. Sometimes this reality and this unreality confront each other, and then we are faced by a contrast which is incomprehensible. Look, I open a copy of the Sunday Times color magazine. Aramis is an attitude. It is not merely proposing a new shaving soap. It is proposing, as it says, an attitude, a life, a civilization. The highest value of this civilization is the individual ego. Pimm's tastes every bit as good as it looks and is easy to drink, which is sometimes hard for us to live with, because we wouldn't want people to think the chords it strikes are all meek and mild-mannered. So, when you're through with your first half pint of Pimm's, stand back and see how you look, and face the hard truth. That song may have ended, but the melody is lingering on. I turn the page. These are photographs of refugees from East Pakistan fled to West Bengal. The text, which accompanies the photographs, says that these refugees deserve more help than any others in the world. The writer appeals to the public conscience. But if I turn the page again, the inadequacy of such appeals becomes obvious. The words and pictures on these pages all appear to be real and all belong to the same language. The text, the photographs taken in Pakistan, the photographs taken for the publicity, the editing of the paper, the layout, the printing, all are elements of the same culture, our culture. Yet between each page, there is such a fissure, such a disconnection, such incoherence, that one can only say this culture is mad. On pages like these, reality itself becomes unrecognizable. It is difficult in this clamor to explain why one set of victims deserves more attention and more help than any others. There have been so many refugees in recent years. Aperitifs can be a bit sweet for today's taste, so a lot of people go to the other extreme and serve dry drinks that taste of nothing. What do words mean when juxtaposed like this? What happens in East Pakistan, or for that matter Birmingham, any historic event anywhere, is always on the far side of the frontier of the publicity dream. What happens out there happens to strangers whose fate is meant to be different from ours. What happens in the dream is meant to happen to us. Things happen after a Buddhist path. There is no communication between the two worlds. Their contrast is beyond understanding, unless one takes a world political view. Yet, what is really the connection between these publicity images and our own lives, between their promises and our own needs? Why, eventually, are these publicity images so bleak? What surrounds these posters? Oil paintings were surrounded by gold frames which symbolized the wealth of the owner within the picture and around it. What surrounds the publicity image is us as we are. Our cities are papered with pictures of what we might buy, papered with dreams which invite us to enter them. But they exclude us as we now are. Behind the paper are hidden our needs. This series began by considering the tradition of the European oil painting. It has ended by us looking at publicity images today, because I believe that in many respects, these images continue that tradition. I have been critical of many things in that tradition, of our culture, of some of the values which it celebrates. And I've illustrated my arguments by using the modern means of reproduction. But finally, what I've shown and what I have said, like everything else that is shown or said through these means of reproduction, must be judged against your own experience.
The final part of the Art of Arts TV is here at 10 tonight on BBC 4. But next tonight, more art as Andrew Graham Dixon takes us on a tour of British art.